but if I had not been here, the first is close male to the front was going to teach his class, Charles. Because Doug, I don't think Doug was in here yet. One of the two had been on the spot. There's a story there, huh? All right. Now, I was delivering a baby. I don't want that to sound worse than it is, but that's what I was doing. To the class. Let me clarify that. All righty. Oh, me. All right, I think we're on page 182, number 10. Does that ring a bell with everybody? I think it's pretty close where we were when we left off last week. Page 182 in your books. Let's have a word of prayer before we begin our class this morning. Almighty God, we're thankful for another day you've blessed us with, especially the Lord's Day. We pray, Father, that we'll come together today to worship and praise you and your Son. We pray, Father, that the things that we say and do will be in accordance with thy will. We're thankful for the opportunity we have at this hour to study from thy word. We pray that we'll learn those things that will help us to better ourselves and in service in the kingdom. We pray, Father, that you'll bless us, be patient with us as we make mistakes, help us to try to overcome those things that cause us to struggle. As we gather together this morning, we're mindful of those who will not be able to be with us due to sicknesses or other difficulties that they're facing in their lives. We pray, Father, that you bless them, bless those who are taking care of them, those medical activities that are being used to try to bring their health back. We pray they'll be effective and that they'll receive the right treatment and be back with us before too long. We're mindful of those that as we draw close to the close of a year, those who've lost loved ones this year. We pray that you'll bless them and comfort them and help us to always encourage them in any way that we can. Help us as we participate in activities here, as we try to spread the gospel. Please bless us in our efforts. Help us to be able to reach out and touch those in this community and throughout the world with the gospel. I pray, Father, that you will continue to watch over and care for us as the days ahead as many will be traveling. We pray that you'll protect us, keep us safe. We pray, Father, that you'll forgive us of our sins and help us to always want to strive to do better as we continue to live our lives. Those shortcomings and those things that we leave undone that should be done, help us to become stronger and do more what you'd have us to do. We're so thankful for the blood of your Son, for the sacrifice that he made. He was willing to give his life and his blood upon the cross that we might have the ability to cleanse our sins, to walk in the light, and that we would have a fellowship that's beyond anything that we could imagine. Continue with us. One day take us, Father, to live with thee eternally. We ask it all in Christ's name. Amen. All right, we've been talking about how to deal with church problems, and we're doing the fill in the blank activities and true and false and so forth in the back of the chapter, and we got down to number 10, I believe, and just a little bit of a historical perspective. We've been talking a lot about the conflict that took place in the Corinthian church and 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and so we wanted to, he touches on a number of things here about Corinth, and this is one in number 10. The city of Corinth burned in the year 146 BC and was rebuilt by Julius. Julius Caesar and 46 AD. All right. All right, number one in true or false. 1 Corinthians was written during Paul's first missionary journey, AD 48 through 49. False. When was it written? His third missionary journey, wasn't it? I think that's what it said. Number two, Corinth was a moral city, a good place in which to live. False. We know it was a pagan city. Of course, being in Greece, we know the situation in Greece greatly from Acts chapter 17, when Paul goes to the city of Athens and we see all those gods that they worshipped, so many, trying to make sure they didn't upset any one god. And they even had one to the unknown God. But they were a pagan people. And so this was an immoral city, and it was full of worship to pagan gods. Number three, there are perfect people who make up the church at certain locations. Do I have trouble with that one? We know that's false. You know, and there's misperceptions by a lot of people. And sometimes people come across in such a way that it's not real, but it's perceived. If we try to talk to people sometimes about their lives, we get some responses like, well, you think you're perfect, or you must be perfect, or something like that. And that's not the idea. The idea is that we all are human beings. And as human beings, we're weak, we're frail, we're subject to mistakes of all kinds. And yet God loves us, which is an amazing thing. But there's nobody that's perfect. The scriptures teach that there's no one perfect. And yet sometimes we might convey that to somebody if we have an attitude that's not appropriate. Sometimes people may perceive that that's our attitude, even though that's not valid, but that's the way they perceive us. A person that has a lot of difficulties in their lives may look at somebody who's faithful in service to God and say, well, you think you're perfect. And they may not have ever said anything or done anything to try to convey that idea, well, I'm perfect. But it happens. But we understand that the church, at every location, is made up of imperfect people. And we need to understand that and be humble for the fact that we're not God's children because we have had so great of character, or we've been so moral. But we're children of God because of His grace, His mercy, and the blood of Jesus Christ. And those should be humbling things. Number four, Paul wrote the book of 1 Corinthians. True, okay. we know a number of books that Paul wrote. Paul wrote the books to the person of 2 Corinthians and many others, I believe 13 in all, that we're aware of, or, you know, maybe with Hebrews being a question mark. But somewhere in that ballpark, he wrote majority of the New Testament and certainly was involved in the church at Corinth. Number five, worship is an appointment with God. True. God has prescribed that we worship on the first day of the week, by New Testament example and teachings. The book of Acts is full of how the church in the first century obeyed God's will, and the fact that we are to worship God and we have an appointment with God. So I don't know how it is with you all now, But this just a point for discussion, and I'll just touch on it and move on. But a lot of the people that I deal with now, personally with my doctors and dentists and whatever, if I don't cancel an appointment, I get billed for it. I don't know if your doctors are that way. But what does that say? Their time is valuable, okay? I get that. Their time is valuable, and if you don't show up, you're going to pay for it. Well, think about God. We have an appointment to meet with God today. And if you, we don't think of it in these terms, but if you stop and think about it, everybody that knows to be here and is not here today is saying, I'm going to cancel my appointment. And it's, in other words, it could be something came up that is beyond their control, that they can't make the appointment. That's a possibility. But it could be just saying, I just don't want to spend my time with God. And we don't think about it in those terms. Well, if I chose to do something else today, just because that's what I wanted to do, it's not a big deal. God understands. I'd hate to be the one explaining that to God. God, I didn't come today because I didn't think it would matter. I don't think God would react too well with that. And so we ought to give more thought to that, that we have an appointment with God. And that's why Jesus was just perfectly clear that there's going to be a day in which we will make an appointment. We will be there. We can say, it's not important to me, or I've got other things to do, but there's one appointment we will make with God. And that'll be the day of judgment. And so we need to understand the importance of worship. It's just not something that God throws out there and says, well, you know, if you want to enjoy it, otherwise you don't have to pay attention to it. That's not the way it's described in the New Testament. And even in the Old Testament, the idea of the reverence and respect and the need to be a worship or a procession with God. Yes.
In my time, I've seen people that sick on Sunday, but Monday morning they go to
church. They can make it to work, but they can't make it to church. Yeah, I understand. I've seen, disappointingly, I've seen that same kind of thing. I can't miss work, but I can miss worship to God. And we need to be thinking about that and be more aware that this is an appointment with God when we come together to worship. All right, let's do the five simple questions and we'll move on. What is God's formula for real unity? Truth and right living. We talked about this some last week. Truth and right living. You can know the truth, but that doesn't mean that you're implementing the truth. When you know the truth and you're implementing the truth, that's when we can expect to have real unity. I can know that I'm supposed to treat my brother and sister a certain way, but I don't treat them the way in that which I know is right. That's I've only done half of what's there. So it's a matter of knowing how I should treat one another and how I should deal with situations, the truth, and then the reality of the implementation of it. And so that's why it's so important for truth and right living to have unity. Number two, from what does Paul tell the Christians to flee in chapter 10? Idolatry. Idolatry. And idolatry causes us as human beings, the idea of idolatry, which was very prevalent in their time, we've already discussed that. It's the idea of my focus is not on God, my focus is on something else. And, you know, it could be something that's personal or selfish or whatever, but the focus is not on God, and that's where it should be. And that's why he talks about that they need to flee from idolatry and get away from it. Number three, When our Christian liberty might cause the weak to stumble, how should we handle that liberty? Abstain. There may be something that is not wrong in and of itself, but a weaker brother or sister may say, that bothers me, it caused me to stumble. Then we should respect that and say, understand, then we'll abstain from that so that there's unity. We could always say, I'm right on this. It's just too bad that you're weak. I'm right with this, and that's okay. Well, what does that cause? It causes division. And so we have to be able to recognize the situation and abstain from those things that would cause someone weaker to stumble. Number four, how does the author describe a 40-year-old baby? As pitiful. That's pitiful. It is pitiful. You know, we need to grow up. And part of us not being able to get along sometimes in the church is because of immaturity, even at an older age. We're not willing to give up where we are. We want to make an issue about it. We're not looking at the good of the body. And things like that can cause a lot of problems. But a 40-year-old baby, someone who has to have their way, that's pitiful. And we need to get away from that kind of attitude. Number five, what verse in the scriptures to be read and studied section of the workbook commands us not to go beyond the scriptures? Silence. I've got 1 Corinthians 4:6. Has anybody got anything different than that? It's okay if you do, I guess. But that's looking at all those scriptures that were there. I looked over them and said, I feel like that's the one. And we could look at that if we need to. But I think that answers the question. Obviously, the principle here is what we need to understand. We don't go beyond what the scriptures teach. And we need to be careful with that. And that's what God wants us to do, follow the scriptures. We need to know what they are. And we need to be able to recognize when we're going beyond something that's not found in the scripture. All right. Anything else on this lesson? All right, let's move to 183 and talk about the rapture. Where to start? The basis of most of the teaching, which this is part of premillennialism, is the confusion or the desire for some people to take the book of Revelations and try to look at it as a prophetic book of what's going to happen in this world in which we live in. And what we do is we take scripture that in the book of Revelation needs to be understood as being mostly symbolic and not literal, and to understand the purpose of Revelations. If you look at the first part of Revelations, it talks about the idea of I'm going to tell you through John being directed to write the book, Jesus is saying, I'm going to tell you of things that must soon come to pass. Soon come to pass. And so when you start talking about that and you look at some of the writings of Revelations, you start seeing things that are very symbolic. They are things that are not, just don't jump out the page of Scripture at you and for you to completely understand. So a part of that is the idea that's discussed, I believe it's in chapter 20 of Revelation, about the 1,000-year reign. And so they take that, the people of premillennialism, take that out of context, and they have quite literally, and being trying to be polite, have concocted something that is just totally against Scripture. Where in Scripture do you find the term rapture? Does anybody know? Nowhere. Absolutely nowhere. And so it is a term that has been concocted. And we'll go through this morning an explanation and a discussion about where that comes from and their teachings. And this has been around for a while, but I would imagine that most of us in here, maybe especially those who are younger, don't have a clue about the rapture. And if you do in this audience have an understanding of the term rapture, at least that you've heard it before, it's probably limited in what you understand about it. You may have seen, I haven't seen them in a long time, but you may have seen a bumper sticker that says, in the event that you come upon this, basically, and I'm paraphrasing because I don't remember exactly what it said, but basically, if you, in the event that you come upon this vehicle that's just stalled in, running in the middle of the road, this is the essence of what they teach about that, then this person has been part of the rapture. In other words, they've been taken away. And we'll talk about that and get to it. But rapture is not a term that we usually talk on a daily basis. You probably have come across people that believe in it. And we want to address all that. The idea of premillennialism. I'm trying to think of something that's not coming to me, but the idea of, you know when you go and if your insurance company is like most of them, if you're going to have surgery, you don't just walk in and say, we're having surgery tomorrow. There's a pre-admission requirement. I can't think of the term right now, so maybe you medical people can tell me. But you have to basically go through the process of saying, hey, I'm going to go into such and such facility, I'm going to have this operation, and you have to let the insurance company know about it like 42 hours ahead of time, unless it's an emergency. I don't know if most of y'all are like that or not, but I know some of them are. So there's a pre-thing that has to be done, pre-admission kind of thing. Okay, so what that means is there's something that has to be taken care of before you're admitted. That's why it's called pre-admission. Pre means before. And so premillennialism, millennial means 1,000, and pre means before, so before 1,000. So as I mentioned to you before, they take revelations and talk about the 1,000-year reign. And so premillennialism is that which happens before the 1,000-year reign. And that's just basic term, premillennialism, before the 1,000-year reign. So that's what that means, premillennialism, when you talk about that. Okay, so what does that mean? What does that entail? Well, we've talked about this in passing a number of times in our class. The premillennialist believes that God sent his son. Jesus was going to establish his kingdom upon the earth. Now, I just want you to be very attentive to this and have your ears open to this. The premillennialist teaches that Jesus came to establish his kingdom, but God did not anticipate. Now notice these words, because these are the words that they use to explain their biblical teaching on this. God did not anticipate the rejection of the Jews. And you could go back and fill in some of that discussion. God, who knows all, did not know that the Jews were not going to accept Christ. And so when Christ came to establish his kingdom and the Jews would not support that, God says, well, we have to have an alternative plan now. And an alternative plan was the church. So the kingdom, in their minds and their teaching, has not come. Well, hopefully we can spend some time looking at some scripture to establish that the kingdom is here. That people can be added to the kingdom. That people are part of the kingdom. But that's something else we'll look at. Their teaching is that God had to come up with an alternative plan, and that alternative plan was the church, and his kingdom had not come yet. So they don't disagree with the fact that Jesus ascended back to heaven, but their teaching is that Christ is going to come again. And he's going to take those that are righteous, faithful members of the church, those who are dead, who have died in Christ, and they will be received up in what is called the rapture. It will be a quiet harvesting. I guess that's a term that might be used for it. A quiet harvesting of those people who are faithful to God. Now, that's why you see bumper stickers that says, if you find this car empty, I've been part of the rapture. That's their thinking. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, Jesus will quietly come a second time, and he will basically pluck you up, and he will take you with him. That's what they talk about Christ's second coming. Quietly, you will just all of a sudden miss somebody and you won't know where they are. You won't know what's happened. It will just be as if someone came as a thief in the night and takes you away. Okay, so we understand that's the rapture. People will disappear because they're God's faithful and those who have died in the Lord. Now, if you know Scripture, you're going to see some stark contrast between what the Bible teaches and this doctrine. But for us to understand it, we have to lay it out and discuss it so that we have a good feel for it. So that's the rapture part of it. And there are people who actually believe this. Now, so when that happens, it's going to be sort of secretive. It's going to be something that catches people unawares. But you would obviously see the results of it, right? You would have perhaps graves that are opened up. You would have people that you know, that you associate with, that have disappeared. So it's not as if we don't know the rapture's going on, right? So everybody that's lived so far and all of your experiences and anybody that you know in the past, has the rapture occurred yet? Do you have any stories where people just disappeared and cars left idling in the middle of the road? Do we know about that? Well, the answer is no. And if you go back and look at it, and I don't have all the statistics here, But I'm just trying to convey to you the teachings that these people have and where they've gone with some of these. So, they have forecast a number of times. I know one, seemed like one date that was in 1948. Every time it's forecast that this is going to happen, the time comes, and guess what happens? It passes. And they said, oh, I must have miscalculated that. Let me go back and calculate it again. And they say, no, it's next month or 3 months or next year. And every time it has never happened. And there have been different people that have picked this up and carried it. In one thing that I looked at, there was someone who wrote a book about this, and he sold 3 million copies. Now, this was back in a time when you don't have that kind of record sales. And so 3 million people said, oh, I want that book. I think it's going to happen. I believe in the rapture. Remember now, Scripture doesn't talk about it. What they say is the truth cannot be found in the Scripture. And they take things out of context to get what they want to discuss. So just keep that in mind. But in one case, a man that was proponent of this was going through the same motion, sold 3 million books, and missed the date again himself, and changed the date several times, still never happened. So, there are people who sincerely believe in this. So we're not making fun of it, but we're trying to show that this biblical, they think biblical teaching, this truthful teaching, is what the Scriptures are talking about. Now, how do they do that? They have to stretch it a great deal. They have to take the thousand-year reign as literal. And so, this misapplication of the book of Revelation, go figure for that one. How many times has that book been taken and misconstrued in the biblical world because people didn't understand what Jesus plainly said in the first chapter of Revelations, that I'm here to tell you things that will come shortly. And yet we try to stretch them out over a number of years to say, well, they're still coming, and this day's coming, and this is going to be catastrophic or whatever, and this is what Revelations is talking about. Okay, so let me get back to where we are. So the rapture is where they say this will all start. So Jesus will come and take those who are accepted of God, who are living the way God wants. That definition is not really that clear, but the people who are God's people. And they'll be taken in the rapture. Now, those that are left, the earth will continue. Now, we know what the Scriptures teach. When Jesus comes the second time, we understand from Peter that the earth is going to be destroyed with a fervent heat and be burned up. That's not what they teach. They teach that those who remain from the rapture will continue to live upon this earth. There's going to be 7 years of great turbulence, like never been seen before. And rapture, the 7 years, and then the thousand-year reign, okay? This is what they believe. So the rapture, we talked about a little bit, what that means. The 7 years. The 7 years of great turbulence. The first 3.5 years. Now, I want you to understand this, because this is something that is, for us who believe the Scriptures, you're going to find yourself really scratching your head on this. But this is what they teach. The first 3.5 of the 7 years, God is going to restore. The Jews will all come together as a nation in Jerusalem. They're all going to be from every corner of the world where a Jew is. They're all going to be brought back together. And they're going to be in Jerusalem. They will rebuild the temple that Solomon had originally built. And they will go back to the law of Moses and all of the animal sacrifices. That just sounds a little strange. But that's what they teach. So stop and think about that. In this, as I said, I'm trying to be as polite as I can about this. But you find it hard to go to the extent of their talking about. Logistically, potentially, how hard would it be if we're living in the 7 years of chaos and of great conflict that's going on in the world, with the possibility of getting all the Jews back in Jerusalem or back in that area? What's the possibility of that happening? It sounds really hard. It sounds sort of far-fetched. And then to go back and build the Solomon temple, that would require a lot of effort to build that temple. And then to go back and offer those sacrifices. That's really hard for me to accept, but that's what's supposed to happen. And during this chaotic time of the first part of the 7 years, 3.5 years for that to happen. The second 3.5 years is going to be in a great, huge conflict. There's going to be a conflict, a great battle. And that battle is called the Battle of Armageddon. Armageddon. Because that's what's mentioned in the book of Revelation. Well, when you start to investigate Armageddon, broken down, simply means the mountain or hill of Megiddo. And I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. But anyway, that's how I'm going to pronounce it. I'll try to be consistent, not call it five different things while I'm talking about it. Megiddo was a region in Israel. There were a number of battles that took place there. If you go back and read the history, all the way back in the Old Testament, it's the place in which Saul and his sons were killed. There were a number of things that happened there, and you can look at the history of them. But Megiddo was a place. Armageddon simply means the hill or the mountain of Megiddo. And so this is supposedly where this great 3.5 year war is supposed to take place. And so once again, if you look at it, and it's used several times, as I said, in the Old Testament times, of where battles took place. So it was a place where a lot of battles took place. And it is not, which is mentioned one time in the book of Revelations, it's not that's where the battle is going to take place, or it's not, this is this catastrophic battle.
So Israel set that up as kind of a killing place, that whoever came from the Golan Heights had to come through that valley. Mm-hmm. And it's been like that for thousands and thousands of years. You cannot come off the sheer cliffs of the Golan Heights. You have to come through the valley of Megiddo, and they see that as kind of a battlefield, and it always has been a battlefield.
it's a strategic point. Like you said, anytime you're going to do battle, you got to figure out your strategy. And if you're going to try to defend or whatever, you want that kind of strategy to have that advantage. And so that's why a lot of battles took place there. But the premillennialists want us to believe that there's going to be this catastrophic conflict for 3.5 years. The Battle of Armageddon. It is going to be the bloodiest. It's going to be the worst kind of thing that's going to take place. At the end of that is when Christ is going to come again. Now, if he comes again, at that point, how many times would he have come? That'd be his third. He came again during the rapture. That was his second coming, to take those people up who were considered to be the people that God would accept. That was the second coming. The third coming is for him to come and to have a 1,000-year reign. Now, that's a story. That's what the premillennialists believe. And that's what we're dealing with when we talk about the rapture. This mindset or this teaching that they have accepted. The problem with that is that it goes against so much of what Jesus said in Scripture about what he was going to do. So much about what the inspired writer said about what God would do, about what Christ would do. And yet in this book of Revelation, which is symbolic to a large degree and not literal, I mean, if you could start talking about the literal aspects of Revelation, we need to read some of those texts and talk about frogs coming out of something, or talking about great beast, and talking about all these other things that would have existed for real if it was literal, that would be happening during this time. Dragons and all kinds of other things that would take place. And so it's a book that people, when they misappropriate it, look at the wrong things, when they don't understand it was something that was soon to come to pass to those Christians that were living during the time of John's writing. And you take that and you try to extrapolate it for thousands of years or so after the time that they lived in, and try to say, well, that's what's fixing to come. We're going to have this. We're going to have that. Oh, the earth's going to be burned up with this. And so that's what's happening, talking about the book of Revelations or whatever. And I know I'm sort of rambling here because there's so many things to talk about that are symbolic there that if they were literal, we could bring all those up and talk about them. But when you read something that you don't understand, then your mind may run wild to any kind of imagination and try to fill in the blanks. Well, that's what a lot of people have done. If you limit it to the church that was persecuted in the early days and what was going to happen to them, then you can start understanding some of the book of Revelation. But when you try to take it and describe it as things that are world events, now here's the thing. People have made projections out of the book of Revelation for I don't know how many years, and every time they do, it never comes to pass, which means we don't understand and have misapplied what's taught in the book of Revelation. Premillennialism is a concocted story concerning how God's going to deal with us in the end of the world. And so we need to understand what people teach so we can talk about what the Scriptures teach. We'll get into this a little bit deeper next week. But please think on these things, and maybe you have some reading material you could look at that gives you some more insight into what the rapture is about. Thanks for being here.